Welcome to the UCA Wallace Foundation Town Hall. The focus of our conversation today is the effort to refresh the Educational Leadership National Standards. Thank you for being here. The Council of Chief State School Officers, CCSSO, and the National Policy Board for Education Administration, NPBEA, are working together to develop Refresh ISLLC, that's International School Leaders License Consortium, and ELIC, Educational Leadership Licensure Consortium. So I'll be referring to those by the abbreviations from here on out. Leadership standards to respond to the challenges school leaders face today. CCSSO and NPBEA are committed to securing the highest levels of involvement and collaboration across the education profession to complete this work. This project has the potential to truly impact the quality and effectiveness of the entire education profession by developing and implementing an aligned and coherent system for developing leaders that will prepare, develop, support, and evaluate them so that they can positively impact teacher practice and student learning. CCSSO and NPBEA are well aware of the increased expectations for students and teachers in our schools today. They know that expectations for educational leaders have also increased and understand that school leaders need to be prepared and supported in order to meet these new expectations, which include shaping a collective vision of student success, creating a school culture that promises success for each and every student, and purposefully distributing leadership roles and responsibilities to other administrators and teachers in their schools so that teaching and student achievement will improve. By refreshing leadership standards, CCSSO and NPBEA will help ensure that states, district schools, and leadership preparation entities have access to model leadership standards that identify the taproots and foundational aspects of leadership practice. Leadership standards play an integral role in informing and guiding the development, continuous improvement, and evaluation of all aspects of school leadership practice throughout the career continuum. With us today, we have six individuals who either serve on the National Policy Board for Education Administration, led one of the standards refresh subcommittees, or served in both capacities. I will begin by introducing each of our guests. Then they will share their perspectives on this important effort. We have some logistics, though, before we get to that. We want to remind you that all of this is indeed, that this is indeed a town hall. We have asked our guests to limit their initial remarks to around 6 minutes to ensure that the majority of the session is focused around questions from all of you. There are two ways for you to ask a question. You can either queue up at the microphone, which is in the center aisle right here, or you can write down your questions and pass it either to Angel Nash or Amy Reynolds. I'm going to ask them to raise their hand. There's Angel, and Amy is over there. Excellent. And they will read your questions for you. Okay? Without further ado, I'm going to go right into the introductions. First, we have James Sobocka. Dr. Sobocka has dedicated his professional life to education. As president of CAPE, the Council for Accreditation of Educator Preparation, he has focused on making accreditation a lever for change and reform in educator preparation to meet the urgent needs of our nation's students. He has a long and distinguished record in higher education. Prior to his appointment as president of the National Council for Accreditation of Teacher Education, NCAPE, he served as a dean of the College of Education at the University of Kentucky from 2002 to 2008, where he also held academic appointments in two departments. Dr. Sobocka started his career in Chicago as a teacher and an administrator. He is the author of numerous books and scores of articles on education policy, administration, and community development. He earned his BA from Harvard College, graduated magna cum laude, and a PhD from the University of Chicago. Dr. Sobocka serves as the chair of NPBEA, and he's a member of the Standards Refresh Committee, co-chair of the ISLLC Committee. Next, we have Joseph Murphy. Joseph Murphy is the Frank W. Mayborn Chair of Education and Associate Dean at Peabody College of Education at Vanderbilt University. He has also been a faculty member at the University of Illinois and The Ohio State University, where he was the William Ray Flesher Professor of Education. In the public schools, he has served as an administrator at the school, district, and state levels. He is past vice president, and a fellow of AARA. His work is in the area of school improvement with emphasis on leadership and policy. He has authored numerous books. Murphy was the founding chair of the Interstate School Leaders Licensure Consortium, wrote the ISLLC standards, and chaired the research panel that produced the revisions to those standards. He is a member of the Standards Refresh Committee and chair of the ISLLC Committee. Next we have Gail Connolly. She has been the executive director of the National Association of Elementary School Principals since 2006. Located in Alexandria, Virginia, NAESP is the only national organization dedicated solely to serving 65,000 pre-K through 8 principals. Her career has encompassed many levels of organizational leadership, development, and management for educational nonprofits at the local, state, and national levels. She believes passionately in the power of education to expand human potential, transform lives, and shape new visions for leading and learning in a globally complex world. Gail is a member of NPBEA and co-chair of the Field Knowledge Committee. Next, we have Dan Dominich. Dan has served as executive director of the American Association of School Administrators since July 2008. He has more than 40 years of experience in public education, 27 of those as school superintendent. Prior to joining AASA, Dominich served as senior vice president for National Urban Markets with McGraw-Hill Education. Prior to that, he served for 7 years as a superintendent of the Fairfax County, Virginia Public Schools. In addition, he has served on the U.S. Department of Education's National Assessment of the Governing Board and as on the advisory board for the Department of Defense Schools and on the Board of Overseers for the Baldrige Award. And Dan is a member of NPBEA. Next, we have Michelle Young. Michelle is the Executive Director of the University Council for Educational Administration and Professor of Educational Leadership and Policy at the University of Virginia. As Executive Director of UCA, Young works with universities, practitioners, professional organizations. Professional organizations and state and national leaders to improve the preparation and practice of school and school system leaders and to develop a dynamic base of knowledge on excellence in educational leadership. Michelle is a member of NPBEA and a member of the steering committee, chair of the ELIC standards and process committees. Finally, we have David Vorath. He has worked with the Department of Education since 2011 after a lengthy career in Hartford County Public Schools. His current work for the state superintendent is to ensure that Race to the Top projects related to teacher and principal evaluation are properly implemented. His education career includes practitioner experience as a teacher, coach, administrator, and district executive administrator, and he has presented nationally on such diverse topics as secondary school reform, high school facility design, and college and career education. David is the chair of the Supervisor Standards Committee. Okay, all right, so those are the introductions, and we'll jump right into it and get started. All right.
Thank you very much, Mark, and good afternoon, everyone. Back in 2008, our last iteration of the leadership standards, the comment was made that educational leadership is more important than ever. And really, since that time, if anything, the evidence has mounted about the importance of leadership in producing effective schools and learners who are able to achieve at high levels. We have a growing body of compelling research, a knowledge of best practices, and a growing accumulation of promising practices that reflect the societal and educational changes which affect the responsibilities of educational leaders. And of course, the policy context within which all of us as professionals operate since the last iteration of the ISLLC standards was developed has changed considerably. We have the college and career ready standards that were not in place at that time, which raise the expectations for our nation's students, and of course, in turn, raise the expectations for our teachers and leaders. We have a lot of changes in federal and state policy that impact upon our profession. We have a very influential report that the Council of Chief State School Officers released in 2012, emphasizing our responsibility and our promise. And not least, we have the new CAPE standards that set a marker for where we believe our profession needs to go. So I think it's fairly self-evident that there was a need for us as a profession to step forward and look at the standards in place and see what we could do to change them. And as I think Joe will make clear in a few moments, it's more than a matter of making some minor modifications to these standards. In a sense, there is a new foundation alongside rewording and reorganization. So this is something significant for all of us. Mark indicated, this project is a co-sponsorship of CCSSO and the National Policy Board on Educational Administration. Joe and I co-chair the overall effort, but really it involves a wide range of stakeholders, even beyond the members of the National Policy Board. We've really tried to be inclusive in our definition of the profession as we've engaged in this effort. The slide here indicates the various committees that have been at work: the Laws Committee, the Field Knowledge Committee, the Standards Update Committee, the ELCC Standard. Well, I'll let you read that. You can see that it's been a kind of complicated effort with many pieces that have to be coordinated. But that's the way we felt we needed to best organize this effort. I do want to say just a little about the ELCC standards as a kind of preview of what I think Michelle will get into in a little more detail. The program standards are so very important to us, and as head of CAPE, I have a special interest in how those standards are developed. You may know that CAPE, as a new accrediting body, established a set of standards in August of 2013 that really do try to raise the bar for the way we prepare teachers in our field. And we would have, in that high-profile commission that we created, included the work of leadership if we thought we could have done this all at once. But it just wasn't possible. And it happens that the ISLLC project comes along at just the perfect time to align the CAPE standards with the new ELCC standards. CAPE has adopted the standards for advanced programs, but they are yet to be really fleshed out in detail, and so I think ELCC will be one of the first professional associations to come forward with new standards. And what does CAPE say about what we need to emphasize as we move from teacher education to leadership preparation? Well, we say that we need a much stronger clinical model than we've had before in our field. We need to recruit into our programs for academic ability and diversity in a much more strategic way than we have in the past. We need to give attention to measuring what we do with much more care and sophistication than we have in the past, including looking at the impact of the leaders that we produce once they are in the field. We need to focus on continuous improvement of our programs using this stronger evidence, drawing on what we know about high-performing organizations and how they work in teams to use data in short feedback loops to improve their programs. And we need to focus with a laser beam on how our programs contribute to the improvement of P-12 student learning. And in a sense, this is a very major challenge for leadership. It's difficult enough to trace the impact of teachers on improvement of student learning once they've left the programs, but there are more complications in our field. But that doesn't exonerate us. It does not eliminate the challenge that we have to focus our entire profession on the improvement of P-12 student learning. And I guess the last thing I would want to say is I'm very optimistic about the impact that these standards can have. We already nationally recognize 380 out of the approximately 500 leadership preparation programs in our country. And there are others that come through accreditation that are not part of the national recognition process. So if you want to look at our potential impact on improving our profession through these national standards, leadership really has a great role to play. It's actually a larger market share than we have in teacher preparation. This is all about strengthening the voice of our profession. It's about moving beyond simple rating systems. It's about moving beyond simple government regulation. It's about creating the kind of profession that we can be proud of and which we know will contribute to the needs of our nation. And I'm happy now to turn it over to Joe.
Now, Mr. Bunny. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
It's really a pleasure to be here. I want to acknowledge the committee that did this work. They stand front and center, so I want to make that very clear. Who developed the draft ISLLC standards from the committee, which is what you have in front of you. My sense is where we are is we're pretty close to the end here. We have two more stops to make. One is with the National Policy Board for Ed Admin has to look at the standards and make some decision, and so does the Council of Chief State School Officers. But I think we're seeing the end of the end of the voyage, so we're pretty happy about that. And we just came from a session before this where we talked about the standards, and I think I was talking to Jim before this. I think one of the nice things is about 97% of the questions were about where we go. Nobody was poking into, you know, on the functions, and I think people are ready for this trip. It's fairly transformational view of what school leadership can be, and so we're the committee is very excited about it. So I just want to do a couple things. I want to talk a little bit about the research base that supports this, and we'll come, that's the end slide. We'll see that at the end, and I'll show you where it is. The major point when we get there is you can take the URL and go to where these sites are. We have about 2,500 pieces of theoretical and empirical work that grounded this these standards. So this is not a bibliography, I'm going to show you. It is actually a link to the research that was looked at and the theoretical conceptual work on these issues that was examined to make the standards grow. Okay, so that's one thing. I want to cite a couple people who were people who led some things for us. Our work is to create the standards, which is to inform other work as they go forward. There was a committee that worked before us, which was called the Field Knowledge Committee, and I want to acknowledge Terry Orr and the Field Knowledge Committee, because they went out and talked to superintendents and principals, did surveys, spent over 1,000 hours working to collect the vision of what leadership was from the craft knowledge, if you will, from the professional wisdom that's out there. And that was quite influential in shaping our understanding of what these standards look like. And I want to acknowledge in particular Mark Smiley. Mark was the person who looked at all the external feedback that we received about the standards, did a very amazing report about that, and then worked at the very end to change some of the language based on the feedback. So I want to acknowledge that. The other thing I want to, really the one thing I want to say is this isn't, a set of ideas that coalesced out of the atmosphere. The standards are grounded on the two pillars of great schooling, and everything in the standards grows from that perspective. And every great school that ever was, every great school that is today, and every great school that ever will be, rests on two and only two pillars. One is this powerful sense of academic press, challenge, pushing and pulling and dragging kids to success more than they thought they could do and more than their families oftentimes thought they can do. And the other is this sense of culture, creating environments in where kids are known, cared for, respected, loved, have opportunity to participate, receive recognition, exercise leadership, and at the end of the day have stake ownership in the building in which they live. Right? So it's those two pillars, and all of the standards build off of those two pillars. You can see them there. So when people say, well, what's the intellectual infrastructure? What's the basis from which this work grows? That's the picture I think we would present. You will see three grow directly from academic press. They're pretty obvious. I don't need to read those to you. You have them in front of you. Four grow directly out of the notion of creating productive culture, places where kids are known, places where teachers have professional community, places where there's meaningful engagement with community members, and then this powerful notion of culturally appropriate space for children in schools. So those are, and then you can see the four that link everything together, vision and continuous improvement are first and last, and then some very powerful notions around productive management. And to go back to where we started in 1995, this powerful understanding of leadership as a moral enterprise and the notion of ethics. So that's the basic story, you know, in my time I wanted to present, is that I'll close with this. If you want to have access to the knowledge base under which that fueled all this work, this is your time to get it. It's up on the UCEA website, thanks to Professor Young for that, and really will take you into anything you want to know. We are, CCSO is bucketizing that list, so they'll begin to appear by standard. Eventually that will be up, but right now the totality is there. So that's the story, and I will pass the clicker along to Gail. You need a clicker?
I do.
You do.
Thank you, Joe. I'd like to start a little bit, going down back in history just a little bit. Since the 1990s, the ISLLC standards have really been the foundational body of knowledge that our association, the National Association of Elementary School Principals, working in collaboration with our colleagues at the Secondary Association, and then with our good friends and colleagues at the School Administrators Association, AASA, we have relied on that body of knowledge to help inform some of the development of some of our own bodies of knowledge to guide the profession. For us, it's leading learning communities. It is our national mentor certification program and all of our professional development programs that we provided over the years have been very deliberately aligned to the extent possible with ISLLC. But what we learned and what we found is that sometimes there was a disconnect between what the standards that were being set for the profession and the realities of what was actually happening at the school building level and in that teaching and learning process, frankly, where the rubber hits the road. And principals were telling us that they didn't feel that the standards were necessarily reflecting the full complexity of the nature of their role. We believe the new standards are going to be much more reflective and very excited to have played a very active role in the development of these new standards through our work with this distinguished panel and bodies who we've been working with, but also because we feel these new standards reflect much more deliberately the voice of principals. And, you know, will the ISLLC standards have an impact on student achievement? You know, that's the holy grail and what we're all hoping that this will be the ultimate result. We know that one of the keys to that happening will be whether or not these standards can play an active role in helping us to enhance the effectiveness of principal leadership, because we know that's a key lever, and indirectly and directly that can influence the kind of student achievement outcomes that we want for our children. And so I wanted to share with you just briefly, this is a very a very summarized section from the full-on reports that you have, but I wanted to give you an idea of how important and how much more reflective the new standards will be of the input specifically from principals, and I would say superintendents as well. We work closely in the focus group and the surveys with Mary and Job at AASA and Dan at AASA as we gathered input from the school administrator perspective, if you will. I'm using the word principal because that's the group I represent, but this is a reflective of the larger pool of school administrators whose voice is now and whose input has been more deliberately integrated into these new standards. And just that quick comparison, you can see where the principal's voice has mattered the most in these new standards has been around this notion of culture and instruction, where it had been sort of lumped together in one standard that didn't nearly communicate and capture the full extent of the complexity as a result over the last decade of these ever-increasing reform measures. So we're very excited about that. Of course, we don't have time to go into them by detail, but we pulled out a two-page summary, I think, that you have that can give you an idea of some of the richness and the depth that has been involved, that has been included in the new standards that we ultimately believe will enable us to create a pool of more and a higher level of effectiveness on the part of principals. This is sort of a simple little graphic, but you know, if we think about the field of education for a moment as an ocean, as a big ocean, and we think of the ISLLC standards as sort of the rain, I hope not a tropical storm or a hurricane, but as a gentle rain that we hope will begin to fill or create some big droplets where the ISLLC standards will influence and to the extent possible align with state licensure, where droplets will form and where the ISLLC standards will really inform and make certain that the policies are practitioner informed. So often there's such a disconnect, as we all know, all practitioners have been living with this reality for some time now, where the policies are set sometimes without any real acknowledgement or understanding of what is actually happening at the practitioner level. And then for us, for our organization, we're very excited because we truly believe that these new standards will help us be able to be more targeted in our professional development for principals that can be really all about helping to build their capacity. And in turn, we hope that practice will help inform principal evaluation. Just a couple of years ago, we developed a paradigm shift, if you will, called Rethinking Principal Evaluation, that really encompasses the multiple dimensions and really captures the complexity of the principal's role that far exceeds a single test score or this preoccupation that we have with testing during this era of accountability. So all of those things together, we believe the ISLLC standards will influence each of those areas individually and in an integrated way that will really focus, and here's that big drop we want fall into that ocean, around building capacity. And if we can build the effectiveness of principals, we believe that will have a ripple effect, if you will, in that big ocean that will lead to enhanced teacher performance and ultimately increased student achievement. And then finally, you know, the $64,000 question is, will the ISLLC standards really result in increased student achievement? Well, time will tell, as they say, but we principals believe that yes, It truly can and truly will if we focus on building the capacity of principals and building their effectiveness, and if the ISLLC standards are truly adopted at all levels of policy that are involved with principal effectiveness. So with that, I would just encourage you to think about in your preparation programs and understanding that these standards now have been truly informed by those who are in the field right now practicing and dealing with the realities of what we all expect from them. And so this is a real message from the field to you to say, embrace these standards because it truly can make a difference. And with that, I'll turn to my colleague, Dan.
Thank you, Gail. What she said. We are the practitioners that are working with the folks that the standards are meant for. And there's no question that the complexity of being a principal, being a central office administrator, being a superintendent today, and I've been in this business for over 40 years, is more comprehensive, more complex, more intensive, more stress-producing than it's ever been. And I think because of that, when we looked at the original standards, the six standards that we were working with, that it was clear that they were meant for another time and not education as we know it today. And so we see that the six have gone to 11, and that there's a much more emphasis on learning, leadership for learning, than there ever has been. And that's right, because that's exactly what is needed today. The one standard, standard two, which was teaching and learning, has now been expanded to three to cover that wide range of abilities and skills and experiences that administrators must have. I don't think any of us would deny that, you know, the teacher in the classroom is truly where the rubber meets the road, where that interface makes it happen. But we also know that without the leadership of a good principal, without the leadership of a good superintendent and central office administrators, that the necessary support and resources that teachers need in order to effectively do their job will not take place. We've all been and traveled and seen enough schools to know that you will not go into an excellent school and not see an outstanding principal. And you will not go to an outstanding school district and not see an outstanding superintendent. Just like you won't walk into a classroom and see a great class unless you have an outstanding teacher. And perhaps, you know, good teachers and good leaders are born, but if that's the case, there clearly aren't enough of them. So we have to take what we have and we have to train them and provide them with the skills so that they can become the kind of innovative, the kind of visionary and effective leaders that we need in our schools today. So for us, the standards become a guideline. We at AASA, the School Superintendents Association, now have in place a certification program for superintendents. And we very much adhere to these standards. And these are individuals, by the way, who are already superintendents with 5 years or less of experience. But if you see the statistics, you know that the average tenure for an urban superintendent is 3 years, and for a suburban or rural superintendent is 6 years. That's not a career. That's what I call being a temp. It's being a migrant worker when you become a superintendent. So there is a need to be able to provide the kind of training and have the kind of roadmap that we need to have in order to make sure that these folks succeed. And the emphasis has to be on student learning. And this is a very comprehensive look. You know, it is not reduced, unfortunately, as it tends to be in the real world, to the results of a standardized test. It's much more comprehensive than that, because we know that it is. We know that it involves the community. It involves the culture. It involves the school board. It involves all of those community agencies that can come and contribute and work towards what we see today is the education of the total child. because it's no longer in the schools about the teacher and the academics. It's also about that outside world, that if the kids come to school hungry, they need to be fed. If they come to school sick, they need to be taken care of. If there's an environment in the home that is negative and not conducive to the child being able to learn, those things have to be dealt with and taken care of. You know, when we look at public education in America today, it's not the suburban districts. I was a superintendent in Fairfax County, one of the highest performing school districts in the country. I was a superintendent on Long Island where we had outstanding schools. Those are not the places where we have the problem. We have the problem where we have concentration of children in poverty. That's where we have the problem. That's where the work needs to be done. And that's why where all of these efforts have to be combined to bring about the kind of results that we hope to develop. And if we have somebody coming into the profession, either as a principal, administrator, or superintendent, who's focused only on the academics and the teaching and the learning in the school, that in and of itself will not be enough. That's why we have these 11 standards, to cover the full gamut. So we congratulate the work that has been done by the folks that are here. It's outstanding. We look forward to continuing this work, to having these standards adopted, hopefully by this coming spring, so that we can turn them loose out on the field and make sure that we begin. And of course, it begins with you at your level, as you begin working with these folks and training these folks to be able to do the kind of work that will lead to providing a quality education for every child in America.
As Jim noted when he first talked about the ISLLC standards and the refresh effort, I've been charged with the revision process around the ELCC standards, which we are renaming the National Education Leadership Preparation Standards, because the ELCC as an entity actually doesn't exist anymore. And ELCC is a little bit confusing for people. So from here forward, we'll talk about it as NELP, or National Education Leadership Preparation Standards. I thought it would be really helpful to start off with kind of an overview of where these preparation standards fit vis-a-vis ISLLC, because primarily we've been talking about just ISLLC so far. So the ISLLC standards are broad policy standards, and frequently we intentionally also invited Gail and Dan to come and talk with us today, because oftentimes ISLLC standards get associated just with the building level leaders. But the ISLLC standards are broad policy standards for all educational leaders, from the building to the district. And that's a really important thing for us to remember. And for preparation purposes, it's also very important, because the charge of our committees are to look at both the beginning standards for principal training and building level leader training, but then also thinking about district level leadership and the type of beginning training that you would expect, so that when somebody leaves the preparation programs, they are ready to take on that leadership role. So the work began with this idea that we were going to be just looking at the standards, but also, as Jim mentioned, with the changes in CAPE, moving towards looking at more outcomes, their focus on the clinical components of programs and selectivity, also thinking about the continuous improvement cycle, and in addition, all of the changes that have been happening at the state level, thinking about the evaluation of educator preparation, the charge expanded to be thinking about not just the standards, but then how they get used around program approval and review, both within accreditation and within the state processes. What you see here are the individuals who have been part of the ELCC committees, both the standards committee and the process committee. And we definitely thank all of them for their commitment to fulfilling this work. This work is kind of in its beginnings right now. Because the ISLLC standards have not yet been completely approved, the ELCC standards because of the strong linkage that they have to the ISLLC standards, and that's a really important part because we wouldn't want to have preparation standards that are preparing leaders for something else other than what we would be, what we're expecting leaders to do on the job. We have to wait until the ISLLC standards actually get accepted before we can kind of kick it into the design phase. So what we've been doing right now is taking a look at how the current ELCC standards are being used, what people's concerns are about the current sets of standards, and then also what their hopes are for the next generation of standards. People have been looking at the new draft of the ISLLC standards and reflecting on them in terms of their implications for preparation. And I just wanted to share a little bit with you from a recent survey that we did. But we did a survey of State Department folks, like our good colleague David here, and as well as education leadership faculty, particularly focusing on the program chairs. We consider those to be the key stakeholder groups because when you think about the national standards, the primary users are accreditation for the purpose of review, states for the purpose of program approval, and programs for design and improvement processes. So some of the key findings. Number one, the vast majority of leadership preparation programs and state approval laws and regulations are aligned with the current set of ISLLC standards and ELCC standards, and they anticipate that they will be adopting the next generation. The process won't be seamless and it won't be right away. The estimated time frame is once the different sets of standards are in place, that you should probably take about 2 to 3 years for the actual adoption to happen. And you might be thinking about your own state, and they may have just implemented a new set of leadership standards. So it's, and in fact, ELCC was just adopted in 2011. So the new NELP standards will probably not go into place for, I would say, probably another year and a half for full implementation. And I'm probably going to put some words in Jim Spolka's mouth right now, but I would imagine, just like in the past, that they frequently have a pilot period where institutions can volunteer to try out the new standards and process. So that's what we're hoping you're going to say anyway. Another thing that we discovered is that most leadership preparation programs are not static, that many of them have been going through changes over time, and some of the most recent changes have really focused on including more information on data, instruction, change theory, and cultural competence within their programs, and I think that's interesting, and it's very much in alignment with some of the new standards that we've seen. Also, in terms of review, we found that 66% of the states that answered the survey indicated that they primarily right now rely on the information that programs provide to them. So they don't necessarily use any other ways of going about reviewing the preparation programs other than looking at state licensure data. But primarily it's looking at the information that programs provide to them about them. Programs, on the other hand, are using more and more a variety of different types of data to be thinking about their programs. They're using portfolios, culminating projects, exams, and a lot of them are trying to look at placement rates and licensure data. But there's a disconnect. Many states do not have the capacity or do not have a practice currently of sharing any data that they are collecting with education leadership preparation programs. So one of the things Dan said about the need for us to be thinking about this systemically is really important, that if we're going to be putting into place a set of expectations for what preparation programs might be doing, the information they might be collecting, we also want to make sure that they have access to that information and a reliable information as well, so that they can include that within their kind of balanced portfolio of different data sources about their program and the impact that their candidates are having in the field once they're placed. Also, about half of the programs reported needing additional resources in order to do the types of reporting that they're currently required to do through accreditation. Although the states, about almost 68% of them felt like they currently have adequate resources for what they're currently doing, if they were required to do any additional type of evaluation, they would need additional capacity. There was also one disconnect that we thought was kind of interesting from our data, and that was the purpose that program reviews actually serve. From the faculty's perspective, it was about program improvement, looking at data for program improvement. And from the state's perspective, it was about program approval, so determining whether or not they had the ability to license individuals. But getting back to something that Joe said, again, most of the programs and most of the states said that they were fully in support of changing the standards in the future. They felt like that was, you know, should be expected, that standards should not be static entities. So in terms of moving forward, one of the things that we also have been stressing throughout this entire process is that we really need to get these standards right. And then once we get the standards right, we really need to think about very carefully how we're actually putting them into practice. So thinking systemically about the different resources and rules and regulations that we put in place will be really important as well.
Thank you, Michelle. Mm-hmm. First of all, I want to thank Michelle for inviting the voice of the state to be a part of this process. I think that's really critical because operationalizing the ISLLC standards or executing them is often a result of state policy or regulation or so forth. And without the voice of the state, those things may not ever become enforceable or operationalized. So thanks in that regard. But as I began to break out this information, it really kind of sorted itself into two pieces when we look at the change in the standards or the introduction of new standards, perhaps for supervisors of principals. The first being, how will these changes, what implications do these changes have for the state's work that it does each year? There are some that are really pretty apparent and immediate. There are others that are a little bit further long range. And then the second bucket of information is more about, once you've decided what the implications are, how do you go about implementing those things in some way that makes sense to get you to a better place as a state? To do that, those two pieces, though, requires you to really look at this work through three different contexts. So before I even start, I would tell you, remember that the first context is the context of local control. When you look at state organizations, LEAs have varying degrees of state control or of local control, excuse me, across the country. There are those states where the state has tremendous standing in the control of the LEAs. And the advantage there is that they can move things quickly across their state because they basically issue the marching orders. The downside is they may be so tied up in statewide policy and regulation, it could take time to do those things. So it's a trade-off to a degree. But that's very different from those districts like Maryland, for instance, which is a very highly localized authority state. We even have counties that believe they're the 51st or 52nd state sometimes. We just have to work with it. But the point is that trying to do the same work in those different state structures is very, very challenging. The second context I would ask you to look at this with is the idea of scale. There's a difference between LEAs that are very, very small and their ability to react to the new standards or execute what's in those standards, or very, very, very large districts. And I think with the supervisor standards that are being discussed, you can see an example of that. In a very small district, the superintendent will be very close to the supervision of those principals. And indeed, it's probably the person that evaluates them. In a very, very large district, the superintendent might actually be three or four tiers removed from the supervision of principals. It doesn't mean that that's not still an important function of that superintendent's job, but the way they're going to use the standards in those states or in those LEA structures is going to be very, very different from in the smaller districts. The third context I would reference is the issue of purpose. In other words, are you going to use these standards to develop high quality, high performing, highly effective principals and supervisors of principals? Or are you going to use this for accountability? I'm not weighing in on which. I can tell you where I believe, though. But those are very different uses of the information. My guess is most states use them for both to some degree. They form the foundation of some accountability issues, what people need to know and be able to do. But then they also are going to be used, hopefully, to craft the work that principals need to be better at their job. And that's the bottom line here. Can we get people to be more effective at the way they do their work, more highly performing? And that should be reflected, quite frankly, in your evaluation processes as well. So when you look at what it means for, for implications, there are five things that kind of bubble to the top immediately from the state perspective. This issue of principal preparation programs and how it's going to be tied to things like the certification or licensure of those individuals, the employment of those individuals, the evaluation of those individuals, and the related instruments and tools that are necessary to execute that work. That's a really easy alignment to make because we've all agreed pretty universally what the role of the principal is from place to place to place. It's very similar. So what you're seeing now is an alignment of the standards to encompass the role of the principal in a way that it really can be used into the accountability piece a little bit differently in the evaluation. When we queried our superintendents last spring about this particular issue and about the standards as they were emerging, what we heard from our superintendents was they really valued what principals knew, but their crisis was more about what were they able to do. It's like the teacher thing. What do kids know and what are they able to do? They had great confidence that they could find people who knew what it was that they needed to know. But they were really struggling with the issue that principals have to have a better practitioner skill set to execute the work. So I think what you see happening with the ISLLC standards is clearly aligned to that. It's putting more emphasis on the execution of the work, the practitioner level of the work, which you would ultimately then see reflected in principal evaluations so that it becomes aligned. So that's an easy connection to make. When you cross over to the supervisors or principals, though, it gets a little bit more difficult to make that alignment because not all superintendents are the supervisors or principals, especially when you get to evaluation. So there has to be greater conversation about how to make this role work in two different ways to the benefit of principal development and the people who supervise those folks. So in this case, there may be no standards for those folks. I would tell you, there are very few references in law or code to people who supervise principals. It's inherent in the superintendent's job, but there are very few places, and I would tell you Maryland is one of the few examples of where there's an actual reference to people who supervise principals. And they very cleverly, and I wasn't part of that, so I don't take the credit, but they very cleverly created a title called executive officer, and they defined it as those people who supervise principals, and then they walked away from it. They didn't go any further than that. There's no license, there's no certificate, but certainly a superintendent fits that definition as well. So it's a little more difficult in terms of preparation programs for folks who supervise the principals and the licensure of those folks, and then the tools. The second bucket I would reference, and then I'll let you get to your questions, because I know that's what you came here for, is this issue of implementation. There are several things that immediately bubble to surface with this as well at the state level. The issue of regulatory changes. In many states, the standards are in regulation. They may even be in law in some states, depending on how it's written. Obviously, while they have great standing, it takes time to change those things. So there's a process that has to play out in those states if you're going to start tinkering what's already written in law versus if you're in a state where it's just assumed as part of maybe an operational piece. There's the issue of communication strategies. Many of us failed miserably with this when we tried to communicate things like the Common Core and parking assessment. This is an issue where if it's going to be effective, there has to be a communication strategy at the state level so that principals and the supervisors or principals know well in advance what it is we're expecting them to be able to do, and building the capacity of the folks to support the work rather than to object or push back on the work. Doing that on the front end versus on the back end of having people react is always beneficial. The state has to take a lead in that part as well. And then aligning what we're doing with higher education. A lot of the work that has to be done will eventually find its sustainability at higher education. People coming out of preparation programs knowing and able to do the work is the long-term solution to sustaining the work, quite frankly. The state can only initiate it or at least direct it or guide it. There's no way most states could actually pull that off themselves. And I think the most critical piece is, and this is something we've learned as well, states really need to sit down with their LEAs early on and craft a plan for how you're going to reach principals, how you're going to share this information, how you're going to hear them throughout the process and keep them informed through a communication plan from day one to the end so they know what kind of legislation is coming, how it impacts their job. And if you're going to have new roles like definitions for supervisor principals, that information has to be on the street well in advance as well. I think it comes back to you now.
Okay, awesome. All right, thanks to the panel for giving out a great deal of information. We want to give you a chance to ask questions. Just a reminder, you can come to the mic and ask a question. We also have little slips of paper. So Karen, if you can grab those, there's some right in front of you, I think, and just pass those back. You can write it on that. Or if you've already written your questions, we would love for you to go to the mic and ask those, or Amy or Angel can come around and get your slip of paper if you have questions you want to ask.
Well, if nobody wants a slip of paper, I stood up, which is probably not surprising. I have a question that's actually directed not at my higher education colleagues, but the other people up there who are more involved with thinking about this from a practice bottom up or more top down. And that is, I'm reflecting, I love the new standards. They really speak to everything that I know from my research, but also from working with principals. I was with a brilliant principal recently in her school, looking at all the wonderful things she was doing, and she had just completed a doctorate with me. And so I said, and when you went through your principal licensure program at the university, oh, she said, oh no, I didn't go to the university. I went to a nameless other local school because it was fast and cheap. This is in some sense represents a challenge more to the areas of practice because A, people hired her with just that credential and knowing that she'd been a good teacher. B, there was no oversight over that kind of quality. And C, I happen to know the inside of that institution, and it's primarily staffed by people who are over 80 and haven't been in a school for a long time. Now, so, you know, if we have this challenge facing us of how to create this truly dynamic focus on preparing professional development and supporting of the school leaders that we need, how do we address little practical challenges like that?
Well, that's a great point, because as we all know, take the superintendency as one example. You know, in Arizona, you need a license to be a barber, but anybody can be a superintendent. We know that there are currently principal preparation programs that will get somebody ready in 4 weeks to be a principal and get them into a classroom, and similarly with teacher programs. So we're at a point in time where the profession is dealing with issues that there are those out there in the public as well who don't understand what we're saying, that these are the kinds of skills, this is the kind of preparation that individuals need in order to be effective leaders at the district level and at the building level. So I think we really have our work cut out for us.
So what's your role in helping to reshape our collective understanding?
Our role is to try to educate policymakers and the public. Okay, that going into a building to run it or going into a district to run it requires an individual that knows the business, that is familiar with the business, who is an educator to begin with, not someone who's just coming in from the outside and is an engineer or architect or some wonderful, or a colonel in the Army, and they can just come in and do it, because they will not be able to meet any of these standards. Some of them, but certainly not the majority of them. So I think we all have to work together. We're working with the principals groups, we're working with the teacher groups, et cetera, to put out there the importance of why people in our schools need to have these skills in order to succeed.
I would just add to what Dan is saying. When you think about the pipeline as it currently exists and how principals are currently tapped, how teachers are currently tapped to consider becoming principals and then becoming principals, I think there's some promise in this new set of standards around principals, supervisors of principals, because that will have an implication for perhaps changing some of those practices through the knowledge and the information of how that is all linked together. And so when you're making that hiring decision, principals tell us they have over many, many years, and it's changing, but it's changing slowly. You know, they're tapped by the superintendent who says, I really think you have what it takes to be a principal. And that's a very subjective, it's been a very subjective process. So ideally, all of this, as we begin to think about it from the systems perspective and understanding the key role that those individuals who are making those hiring decisions, how to help inform their decision making, and how to for that to become an integral part of how we really do focus on how principals are prepared and encourage them at the earliest possible stage when they're tapped as a teacher to be guided to the kinds of quality programs that are by design toward helping them become more effective in their practice.
My answer to that is that the states vary greatly in their willingness to set high standards for program approval. And in some states, an alternative non-higher ed provider is really empowered with very little set of requirements put forth, on the premise that if you're coming from the market, this is a good thing because you're offering an alternative to traditional preparation programs. I think there's absolutely nothing wrong with a competitive market, but the market in our area has to be highly regulated. So the Council of Chief State School Officers happily has spoken on this in the report that I mentioned. They are talking about one set of high standards that need to apply to all programs. So, you know, I think the policy discourse is changing, but we still have great variability from state to state. And I think both our practitioner colleagues and higher ed need to advocate more clearly for a better set of policies.
I'm on. Thanks. I have an interest in state policy as it relates to these matters, too, so I appreciate the thread. I wanted to ask a question thinking about the state's role, but also learning from history. So if you looked at the 2008 ISLLC standards when they came out and you studied the track record of states, you could draw some conclusions about what did states seem to do well? Where did they stumble? I'm curious to hear your thoughts on what those lessons are about the state's role in particular. What did the states do well with the 2008 version, and what did they do not so well with that? And then looking forward, you know, in light of that track record, what do we anticipate will be the difficulties and the challenges going forward from here with the new round? Thanks.
Well, I'll just comment on one piece of this, and that is that, I think that the implementation of this by the states occurs in the context of the state-local control issue that came up, and moreover, in the context of federal versus state-local control, or national versus state-local control. I think in leadership preparation, we're somewhat behind the curve when we compare ourselves with teacher preparation. In teacher preparation, there is now a much greater consensus that we need a common set of national standards to guide us. Their implementation through accreditation is still uneven. But in the field of leadership, we still have a lot of states that believe they should establish their own leadership standards and do not accept the legitimacy of the ISLLC standards or the program standards for ELCC. This is really, it's a barometer, I guess, of the stature of our profession. It's an observation that we have a ways to go in that regard. And as members of the profession, we have to ask ourselves, are we really advocating strongly enough for our profession with a common set of national standards?
You were asking, I think, a little bit of a reflective piece about where we were and where we are. Let me give you an example of how this has played really directly, and I can only use Maryland because it's where I live and work, and I'm most familiar with that. Prior to the 2008 ISLLC standards, Maryland had its own set of instructional framework standards that they were using. They were all instructional. There were like six of them, I believe that was the case. And where we really came to appreciate the ISLLC piece of this was when we were charged by USDE to come up with new evaluation systems for teachers and principals, we found that when we put our instructional framework pieces into the evaluation tool, universally principals said that doesn't capture the scope of what I need to be evaluated on. And we went back to the ISLLC standards, believe it or not, to find the missing pieces that needed to be in principal evaluation that we didn't have in Maryland. And we ended up, after a long drawn out discussion over a year and a half, 2 years, with an evaluation tool that had 11 standards, which is miraculously close. I mean, we had 12, which was miraculously close to the great minds think alike, I guess, to the 11 they ended up here. So what we have done now is we're having the next chapter of the conversation in Maryland, which is going to basically say, if we're now aligned with the 11 ISLLC standards for principal evaluation, why don't we just peel out our 12 standards in our evaluation tool and put these back in and join the national conversation and play off the national resources so that we're thinking similarly rather than independent from the other 49 places in the world. But that also means we'll have to go into our code and change the code and remove the old framework language and replace it with ISLLC language. And I think that'll happen. I think people will figure out it just makes sense to work from the same script than to try and do everything different all the time.
I think one issue here is that even though, as Jim mentioned, the states didn't necessarily full hog adopt the ISLLC standards, they did adopt a similar set of standards. So they're very much aligned. And I think that the issue here is a difference between a broad set of policy standards and what states need for practice standards. The practice standards are what you actually expect a person to be doing in the building or in the district so that they can set licensure according to that, and then also set evaluation and so forth. So, you know, if it would sort of make sense that a lot of states aren't going to say, you know, we're going to adopt these broad policy standards for the purpose of actually, you know, setting expectations for what people in our state are going to be doing within their individual buildings and districts. And in fact, if you take a look at large districts, they typically have their own set of leadership standards. And I think that, again, it's the difference between a set of broad policy standards and practice standards. They've got to be aligned, but you've got to expect that there's going to be some difference.
One of you, and I can't remember who said this earlier, made some comment about the field experience component or internship component of a preparation experience. And there's a lot of research to suggest that that's one of the more potent aspects of leadership preparation. And yet, my personal observation is that many, many universities don't do that so very well. We're not equipped to do it very well. And in fact, in most recent years, I think the institutions that provide some of the richest and most authentic field experiences are those that have significant external funding to do so. And it has a lot to do with the fact that the population we deal with who are preparing for leadership roles, they don't stop and take time out and leave their jobs in order to do an unpaid internship for a year or whatever. It's just not, it's seldom done. So how do we tackle that challenge?
Michelle, that's for you.
Some of the most significant models, as Diana mentioned, are definitely those that have external funding. But there are other models that places have tried. For example, with strong district partnerships, frequently the districts are very interested in creating opportunities for internships or placing individuals in an assistant principal role or within a teacher leadership role, but then providing a substitute to come in and actually take over the classroom so that individual can take on more leadership responsibility. But you're absolutely right. This is one of the things that the field of education leadership struggles with mightily. And until we figure this out, we're in a bit of a pickle. The research shows that individuals who have a strong internship experience are much more likely not to be migrant workers within the principalship. And the same goes true for individuals who are taking on new superintendencies. If they have an opportunity to have some sort of a sheltered leadership experience before taking on their own organization as the leader of that organization, they're much more likely to be successful and stay in that position longer. But currently, there's no clear answer to that question that I know of.
I'd weigh in and say that you know, there's an advocacy component to this. Our organization, for example, right now, just across the river in Alexandria, we have a group of about a dozen principals from all across the country who are actively engaged in developing and enhancing our platform. And one of the issues they spent a fair amount of time on yesterday was that exact issue of how important and what can we do as an organization to frankly demand that aspiring principals be afforded exactly that kind of opportunity as a part of their preparation programs. And at the elementary level, there are only a fraction of the schools that have assistant principals. It's tied to a student population. I think it's something in the neighborhood of you have to have at least 500 students before you can even be considered for an assistant principal. Well, that's an antiquated way of thinking. If we're really looking at this as a preparing the workforce in the way that we need to prepare it in order to get the results that we want, we know that we need to adopt some of the same practices that have served other professions so well over time. And it comes down to money and getting the powers that be to understand that If you invest in building the capacity of your educator workforce by design, that you're going to get the results that you're desiring. So our organization, that's going to be a really strong advocacy message for us. And you know, the way things are with Congress these days, we're not overly optimistic, but that doesn't mean we should stop trying. So that's a powerful message coming from the practitioners that should help on the higher ed side, if we can get our advocacy efforts together to push for what we really believe in.
I think from the state level, there are three pieces I would consider for that. The first is there has to be a strategy for reaching sitting principals. People who are by no fault of their own, the victims of their past experience may not be the right experiences. So there has to be a strategy to reach them in some way. The second piece is, How do you prepare people more effectively who are coming into the jobs? I'll use the sports analogy. If you want to be good for 1 year, you work with your seniors. You want to be good for year after year, you work with your freshmen, right? Same thing here. There has to be a really intensive push for the next generation people coming in to sustain the work, or the work becomes only momentarily. And then the third piece I think needs to be looked at is, there is a tremendous resource out there that we lose every year. They're called retiring principals. People are really good at their work. There are very few job opportunities for these folks to extend their careers, in my opinion, in part-time fashion, because it's either you're all in or you're all out a lot of times. There's a wealth of people out there who could benefit the development of aspiring principals. We're using them in a coaching network now, very intentionally, who would almost, I hate to say it, many of them will work for peanuts because they love the work they do. They just love it. And they don't want to just walk away from it outright. And yet we're losing that resource every single year. And the further it gets away, the less recoverable it becomes, quite frankly. I think there has to be some thought to how to get engaged folks in that situation in their career, how you can keep them actively involved in some way.
Okay, are there other questions? We may have time for one more. We're almost at our stop time at 3:10. Okay. All right. Seeing none, would you please join me in thanking this great panel? Very nice job. Thank you all so much for coming, and have a great day. Yeah, nice job.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.